So we're gonna, as Bob said, we're gonna shift focus a little bit more to the apply part of the meeting, and I wanna spend the first couple of minutes to try to make the case why we should be focus our research, at least from an apply perspective, more to the grow finish compared to where we have been up to this point. And I would like to acknowledge VI for sponsoring this session. So, again, when we look at the cost of oh, and before I get started on my end, just an announcement for the poster session. The room will be available this afternoon, my understanding. So just keep in mind, if you have a poster, get ready to set it up this afternoon. Okay? So going back to why I think we need to start looking at the grow finish again is because one, we've known for a long time that PERS is very costly, and when we look at the cost of PERS, we see that most of the cost actually comes from the grow, the losses incurred in the grow finish peaks. So Dr. Holcomb and Daryl Holcomb at ISU have shown that in the different studies and in the more recent study, he estimated that 62% of the cost to producers is still because of the impact of the virus in grow finish, okay, compared to the impact to the, in the sow farm. So that's important to keep in mind. But when we look into most of the strategies that have happened up to this point, obviously they've been done in the breeding herds. All the protocols in terms of herd closure, or gill acclimatization, time to stability, etc., the focus has been on the breeding herds because we wanted to produce a PERS negative pig, okay? We will not be able to make an effort in controlling PERS in the grow finish unless we start with a pig that is PERS negative. So, rightly so, we spend a lot of effort and a lot of investment the producers have on improving biosecurity in the breeding herd, on changing a lot of the things that happen in the breeding herd, to try to attempt or try to have a PERS negative pig. Okay? However, when we look at the reports from the Morrison Swine Health Monitoring Projects that measures the level of incidence of PERS over the years, it hasn't really changed that much. It actually ranges between 20% to 40%, and only in the 2013 and this last season, we were in the lower end, 20% incidence in the breeding herds. In the other years, would range above that. So it's always interesting to see that after, let's say, what the industry perceived as a significant health challenge, 2013 was PED, and recently it's been ISF in China, that we see maybe increasing on the biosecurity, and perhaps, I'm just speculating here, that's why we see a lower incidence in the breeding herds. But nevertheless, we have to question what else, what is the missing piece that why we are not quite making the progress that we were expecting to make in the breeding herd, despite all these efforts and all these investments that we have done. So do we have to take a look, or are we ready to look at finishing pigs as a risk factors to control PERS also in the breeding herd? Again, when we look at the reports from the MSHIM data, and some of you are familiar with the reports, that they are produced on a weekly basis, and it looks at the percentage at the industry, this represents about 50% of the sow herd in the U.S. We have that about 35% of the herds, they win negative pigs, about 30% they are positive at winning, and again, then the possibility of a spread virus. And another one, about 35%, they are part of the stable. So basically, for the most part, those pigs will be negative at winning. But then, what happens to those pigs that are negative at winning or stable? What happens once they make it to the finishing sites? So again, there is limited data that it's published or at least found in proceedings, and even the data that you can see here is from 2013. So we don't really have a lot of recent data that tells us what really happens in those pigs. So we see, for example, in the study from Holcomb in 2013, we see that 38% of the groups went from being placed negative to being to seroconverting or becoming positive during the growth finish period. Okay, and another study was 26%. So again, that illustrates that there is quite a bit of activity in the growth finish that maybe we need to understand. So the question then is, what happens in the finishing pigs, is that a risk for the sow farms? And there are a couple of cases like the pseudorabies days in the U.S. where, again, controlling the disease in the growth finish was important to make efforts on the regional elimination of PRV, and more recently on PED as well by the group Machado and Kim van der Waal, looking to the role of moving infected pigs into what they call the neighborhood of a sow farm and the incidence of PED in those herds. And then they saw that, again, when you move positive pigs into an area, the risk of the sow farm to become positive also increases. Interestingly, in the case of PERS, there is not that many studies yet. One is a study that Jose Angulo and Paul Yeski did a couple of years ago, and they start looking at some of these data from the field perspective, in which they look at the dynamics of infection in the sow farms, but also the dynamics of infection in the grow finish. And I will not talk in detail about this study, but they did see that there was an association between the level of prevalence in the sow farms or the detection in the sow farms and then the risk of, or the detection as well in the growing pigs. And there was also that temporality and that relationship and also looking at the different genotypes of virus. So again, there was that evidence that what happens in the sow farm, on the grow finish, then also had an impact on the sow farms. But unfortunately, we don't know much about, I still think even with these pieces of information, we don't know much about the risk factors that trigger those infections in the grow finish, or even what's the best way to control PERS virus in the finished pigs. So to that question, how much do we know about what happens in PERS in grow finish? I don't think we know much. And that's the purpose of the presentation, the next presentations today, it's to show some of these groups that are already working at trying to figure out what happens in grow finish to present it here. So again, I think there is evidence that suggests that from a control point of view, if we really want to make effort in advancing the PERS control in the region, we have to look into the growing pigs. Again, the growing pigs, we've seen for other diseases that represent an infection risk for the sow farms, but we really don't have a lot, a good picture about what happens, at least in the U.S., in those grow pigs. So we need to look into what do we have to do there if we really, really want to make progress on the eradication or elimination projects.